We're so glad you've decided to join us for this week's message from Anchor Chapel in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. Our hope is that you're both encouraged and challenged in your relationship with Jesus. Be blessed as you listen to this week's message.
So I don't know if you're like this with sports. For me, I'm not like a real big fan of just competition for the sake of, like, you know, having teams play against each other. I'm a big fan of winning. Like, I don't really care for losing that much. So, like, if I'm playing something, I don't care to lose. I want to win. If I don't, you're going to see it on my face. I can't hide it. I'm just a very competitive person. That's why I have a hard time rooting for teams, because, like, it's never your year every year for your team. You're never going to win even Alabama got a wake-up call this year. It's not always your year. It's not always everybody's year. And to me, when I watch a game, I'm not like the kind of person who's like, man, that was a good game. It was 35-34. It was incredible all the way to the end. I'm like, man, that was a good game. It was 75-2. I loved it. It was like incredible. We just blew them out the water. And like everybody's like, this is boring. I'm like, this is what I live for. I want to see people murdered on the field, you know? I just want to, like, I want to see somebody really get it. And I don't know if that's a Christ-like thing to say at all, you know, but I do think that the aggression and the feeling that we want to win at all costs and you know, I think that that's a characteristic of what the church is meant to do, that we are not supposed to just sit idly by while the enemy gets a bunch of plays and he wins some and we win some and we just fight and, man, it's just a battle. It's a struggle. I'm human. I don't think that's the place that we as Jesus followers are supposed to comfortably walk in, that we're like, I'm struggling. I'm always fighting. I'm always losing. I think we're called to win. Jesus has already won. He's already a victory that we fight from, that he won at the cross. I think that the church should be victorious on a regular basis, constantly. But I see the church losing a lot of battles. I see individuals losing a lot of battles. I see myself losing a lot of battles. I think that we are supposed to be a church that is very intentional, that is very aggressive whenever we see the attack and the opportunity of the enemy's trying to look for to get in. I think we need to be incredibly aggressive and meet him right where he is. I want to look at a passage of scripture that is, there's a lot of stuff going on in this passage, and I'm gonna try to open up some of the deeper things in it, but I don't want to lose the focus of the main passage, so stay with me. There's going to be a lot of like history in this today, but it's very interesting to me. Matthew 16, it's a story that you may know. Jesus is talking to his disciples, and he basically brings them to this place, and he asks them, who do you think I am? Who do you say that I am? And Peter has this revelation about Jesus. So let's pick up in Matthew 16, verse 13. It says, now when Jesus came to the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, who do people say that the Son of Man is? And they said, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. And he said to them, but who do you say that I am? Simon Peter replied, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter. So he changes his name in this moment from Simon Bar-Jonah, this is his full name, to Peter, which means rock. On this rock, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Then he strictly charged the disciples to tell no one that he was a Christ. So there's this picture of the church in this passage that really gives a good sense of what the church should be, what the church should look like. Now, I've always read this, and I've never noticed this before. This kind of just glossed over this detail, but where Jesus is coming from is significant. I've always thought that Caesarea Philippi was kind of on the tour of teaching, on the tour of miracles that Jesus is on, and they're just walking by, and they stop, and they're like, oh, by the way, who do you say that I am? Well, if you look into it a little deeper, the last thing that happens is Jesus is talking with the Pharisees and Sadducees, and they are asking him, show me a sign. So the Pharisees, Sadducees are religious leaders. They're the priests of the day, and they're challenging Jesus, and they ask him these questions. Can you do a miracle for us? Prove to us that you are who you say you are. Jesus ends up saying, a wicked and perverse generation is looking for a sign. He's making a point. I want you to know me. I don't want you to look for religion or look for these signs. I want you to look for me. That's the message Jesus is trying to get across. So he's fighting and he's making this illustration against religion is what Jesus is trying to say. Jesus ends up taking this a little bit further, and he's trying to talk to them, to the disciples, about the religion that these religious leaders have at the time, what the church is. It's very religious at the time. They're in this place called Magadha. This is the town where they're in. Jesus makes this statement about Caesarea Philippi, but he has to travel 30 miles north to get to Caesarea Philippi. So they're in this one place. They're on the west bank of the Sea of Galilee, and they travel 30 miles north to get to Caesarea Philippi. Jesus takes his disciples up there, and this is where this encounter happens. This isn't just this tour, because they end up going back south afterwards. This isn't just this tour of ministry. Jesus goes up to this location specifically to make a point. Jesus is trying to illustrate something to his disciples and to us in this location. There was something valuable about this location. This is what Jesus thought of the Pharisees in Matthew 16. Right before they leave, he ends up telling this to his disciples. He says, beware of the yeast of the Pharisees and Sadducees. So if you ever break bread, like one of my things is, it's going to like totally lose my man card here, but I love baking bread. So like, I have a bread machine. I buy like different kinds of breads and I experiment with different breads. I'm like, I love this. And I'm like, don't tell anybody because it's kind of sissy, but like, I like making bread. So I bake bread in my house. So I know a little bit about yeast. You need yeast for the bread to grow. And one of the interesting things about yeast is once it's in the dough, you can't get it out. Once the yeast is in the dough, it's going to begin to rise. And there are different types of yeast, and it may rise quicker or slower. But Jesus is saying, hey, you guys know about yeast? You know, you can't get it out? He said, this is the danger of this teaching of religion that you're hearing right now. Let me take you to another place so that you can get a completely different message than what they're saying. There's a danger. There is an infection. What they're saying, it can be an infectious disease in the body of Christ, in the church. So he's trying to get them out of this environment so that they can hear something else. Now, what is Caesarea Philippi? Caesarea Philippi is a location where there was a large cave and there was a fountain, there was a fresh spring coming out of this cave. Now, the ancient Greeks and Romans believed that Caesarea Philippi and this large cave and this fountain coming out was literally the gates of hell. This is what they called it. They literally thought this was where the false god Pan would come in and out of this cave. They believed that this false god Pan would come in and out. And Pan was a false god that they believed kind of, he had a human torso and human upper body and a goat lower half. So he was had goat legs, and he was always seen as or known as playing a flute or playing some kind of a wind instrument to kind of seduce people and get people's attention. Now, the creature that I'm thinking of right away is like, I don't know if you've seen Narnia, but this is basically Mr. Tumnus would be like a representation of Pan, the false god. It's like, I knew I couldn't trust him. But actually, he does this in the movie. He plays this flute and he seduces the kids and tries to get there, you know? So that's basically where this idea comes from, is this Greek god, Pan. Now, what's interesting to me about all of this, about what happens here, is there is actually there's some historical evidence that this false god like continued, and this teaching of who he is kind of continued. And I even see remnants of this today. I don't know if you've heard of the Pied Piper. This is kind of a folklore tale that in 1284 in Hameln, Germany, the Pied Piper comes to town because there was a rat infestation in Germany. And this was all these diseases that were spread by these rats, and they couldn't get rid of the rats. So apparently the Pied Piper comes to town, and he's got this magical flute, and he plays his flute, and he walks out of town, and all the rats follow. Well, they didn't pay the Pied Piper. They didn't pay him, and this is where maybe you've heard the phrase, pay the piper. Well, they didn't pay him, so he came back, and in revenge, he came and he played the flute and stole all of the children from Hameln, Germany. And I looked it up, and I'm like, this is like a folklore tale, whatever. Well, like, it's so old, it's such an old story, but they really believe that this guy existed and that some way he stole the children. And the reason I bring this up is this is an illustration today, and it is reminiscent of who Pan was, the reason he played this flute, all this stuff. There was a seductive nature to this false god Pan. There was a seductive nature, just like the Pied Piper. There was something that would draw people in to the gates of hell to entertain this false god. And when you look around today, and you can see the way the culture is, the way the world works, it is very difficult to make black and white statements now. It's very difficult to say this is right, this is wrong. We live in a very gray world, and even among Christians, there are so many vastly different opinions about what is right, what is wrong, what is current, what is an ancient idea, what is valuable to us today, what is a way we should live by, what is something that's just an opinion, don't put that on me, don't put that on somebody else. There's such a division in our world today, not just from politics, but from the view of what is truth, what is right and wrong. There is a seduction today for us to enter into sinful activities, but because they can't really be bad for us today. Surely that's not relatable for us. Surely that's not what you're trying to say. So you may be, it could be something as simple as, I think I'm going to watch Game of Thrones. Game of Thrones is popular. It's all over the place. I don't even know if it's as popular as it was, but Game of Thrones, okay? So I'm going to watch that. You know, that's one, you know, there's a lot of nudity. There's a lot of inappropriate stuff, but I can watch it. It doesn't really bother me. Well, then where do you draw the line whenever you begin to look at or see some softcore pornography or then hardcore pornography, and there becomes this gray line? Where do you draw the line? What is right and wrong for me? See, I can handle it. I can deal with it. I can do it. The rules that I have are different than the rules everyone else has. Where do you begin to draw the line? Or maybe for you, we've got Mardi Gras coming up and parades coming up. Where do you draw the line between just family fun and parades? Because there's not anything inherently evil in going to a parade. But where do you draw the line between that and then engaging in drunkenness, or drinking too much, making a fool of yourself, and maybe even ultimately Christ? So where do you draw the line between the things that you say, surely that's just fun and games, that's not a big deal, that's, you fill in the blank. What is it for you that you would be honest and you said, I've made this a white issue, even though other people say it's a black issue, but this is my decision, this is not a big deal. Maybe it's possible today, and I believe the reason that we're so weak, the church is so weak, and we don't see as many miracles today, and there's not as much power and authority in the church, is because we have allowed sin to seduce us into thinking, I can live this way, I can do this thing, I can let this sin in, and I'll be okay. I've got enough willpower to beat it later. And the Christian life is not one of putting your foot in the water, but it's one of submerging completely. This Monday night, we went, Judah had a birthday on Monday night. He's 3 years old now. We went to Area 51. And, you know, he's like a brave kid. He's having a blast. We're out there, and there's this trapeze section where, like, you get to go and you get to ride on this trapeze. Well, Judah decides he wants to do it. So we put Judah on the trapeze, and we let him go, and he begins to swing. Now, you can see right here, obviously, he did not realize that at some point, you need to let go of the trapeze. At some point, you need to let your hands go and just begin to swing. And you can see on his face, he's like, oh my gosh, I'm kind of stuck up here now. What's going on? And I'm yelling out to him. You couldn't hear it in the audio, but I'm yelling, let go. Just trust us. Fall. The foam is okay. You're going to be okay. And I thought, man, what a picture of so many Christians that we jump in, that we're like, man, I know I need Jesus. You have a moment where I know I need Christ. I know I need to kind of give him something, but you don't realize that it is a life of surrender. And we give him part of ourselves. You don't have a problem with putting your hands on the trapeze or even jumping out. But at some point, we need to give all of ourselves to Christ. At some point, we need to trust him with the free fall and say, you know what? I understand and I trust that what you have for me is better than what I've been trying to hold on to. And we need to be willing to release, but the seduction of the world is just hang on right here. Just observe and watch and, you know, just don't really give yourself completely to it, because then you won't have this anymore. You won't have this thing, and God's trying to hold something back from you. The original lie, God's trying to keep something from you. Is not the truth, but it is the seduction of sin from the gates of hell, that there was a sin that so easily besets and distracts and gets the attention of all of us to seduce us. Brennan Manning said this. This is a quote that if you grew up on Christian music and DC Talk, you may know this quote. But Brennan Manning said this: the greatest single cause of atheism in the world today is Christians who acknowledge Jesus with their lips and walk out the door and deny him by their lifestyle. This is what an unbelieving world simply finds unbelievable. You know, I just think that's a great illustration of how many Christians are Christians by name only, but the world's looking for some proof. Where's the proof? Where's the all in? Where's the commitment for you to live for Christ and to not give in to the seduction? The world is constantly seduced by sin, and they're living in it, and it's empty. When they look at us, they should say, man, they have something I don't have. Not that they're also stumbling with me. There needs to be an authenticity in our groups and as we meet, and there needs to be, hey, man, I'm with you. I struggle too. There needs to be that, but man, for goodness sake, can we have some victory in the church every now and then? Can we have some celebration of how our lives are different, of how we don't look like we used to look? Shouldn't we look different? Shouldn't we be different? But this seduction of the world, of the gates of hell, are keeping the church powerless. Jesus says right here, he says, look, this is what the church looks like. That the gates of hell are going to have to submit to the church, and whatever you loose in heaven is going to be loosed on earth. Whatever you bind in heaven is going to be bound on earth. I believe that you can't bind what you're bound by, and you can't loose what you've not yet acquired. You have to have freedom in your life before you can show other people what freedom looks like, before you can speak freedom over your family. If you're bound, there's no freedom for anybody else. There's no way out for anybody else. And Paul talks about liberty, and he talks about, you know, as a Christian, we don't live a legalistic life. And I never want to give a legalistic message, but every now and then I need to bring it. But we need to be people that even though we have a liberty that we can live by, that we can make a decision and we can have a moment where we can pray and say, Lord, is this right for me? Can I do this? And some of these gray areas that some people may feel are convictions, they're not going to be convictions for other people. There is a liberty for us as believers where we get to decide with God what's right for us. But when our liberty begins to steal the power of God in your life, or it is straight out of, as we call it, liberty, but it's just disobedience to God, and it's just sin disguised as liberty, there's no power in your life. And here's a good test of liberties. Can you do blank? Can you do this thing and honor Jesus while you do it? That's it. That's a pretty easy test. Can you do blank? Can you do this thing and still honor Jesus? If the answer is yes, then I say go for it. Then you have that freedom. You have that liberty to do it. It's all about honoring Jesus. It's all about lifting up the name of Jesus. If you're going to write anything down today, this is like the statement that is going to solidify this whole message. The greatest tranquilizer to the church is its flirtation with the gates of hell. The greatest tranquilizer to the church is its flirtation with the gates of hell. This is the entertainment of sin. The entertainment of, surely that's not going to be that can't be that big of a deal. Surely I can handle that. Surely I'm strong enough. Surely that can't be for today. But it ends up tranquilizing and harming the church. There was a student in our youth ministry a few years ago who, he would just do like anything you told him to do. Like that kid, basically the kid I was in student ministry too, but he would just do whatever you would ask him to do. And we had this fire at our house one day, this bonfire, and I had this rope swing nearby. And, you know, they would usually swing on the rope and have fun with that, but then we also would have fire. I don't know why we built it so close, but we put it real close. And at one point, we're all talking and like, you know, somebody's just messing with the rope. And I tell the guy, I'm like, man, it wouldn't be crazy if you, like, swing over the rope, you know? And I, like, turn my head for a second, and the dude is swinging over the fire with this rope. So he's swinging over the fire, and at some point, he decides that I am going to not only swing to the fire, but I'm going to swing and jump over the fire at this point. So I'm going to swing over this thing, and when it gets to the peak, I'm going to jump. Well, what he didn't realize is like a rope has there's nothing to push off of. There's nothing solid there. So he doesn't quite let it go all the way and just let go and let momentum do it. He tries to jump off the rope, like while it's like not even at its full like taunt length, you know? So he's in the middle of the fire and he decides to jump, and basically the rope just goes away from him and he falls in the fire, right in the fire. This dude gets all burnt up on his leg right here. He's got like, I mean, for couple years. He had this scar right here on his leg. And I'm just like, oh my gosh, I'm just lost my ministry. I'm not gonna be a youth pastor anymore. I like burned this child. And like this, I was like, he was like in high school. But this dude, like, he decides, I'm gonna just jump over this fire. I'm gonna play with fire and not get burned. And man, what a foolish thing to do that you would listen to your youth pastor. Who does that, right? But this guy is swinging over this thing, and he falls right in it, thinking, surely I won't get burned. That's the story of so many people. Surely I can get close to this. Surely it's not really as bad. I mean, it's just fire. It's pretty. There's a seductive nature about sin. You would never want to do it if the devil was like, hey, you want to ruin your life with me? Hey, you want to like wreck your family? Hey, you want to get addicted to something that's like terrible? If he's painting the reality of sin in a real light, you're never going to go for it. But there's a lie that comes with sin. There's a lie in the seduction. It's the reason why we want to do it. It's the reason that even because of Adam and Eve's sin, it's in our blood, it's in who we are, that we long to sin. We tell ourselves lies all the time. There was a lie that sin is attached to. You know what's interesting about this god Pan? It's actually where the word panic comes from. Because it was not only a god who would seduce people in, the reason that he had a few things to offer, apparently. He was a god who could, he was a seer who would give revelations. He was a god of war, kind of, that would make panic happen, that would make this chaos happen on their enemies if you would pray to him. So this is where the word panic comes from. And this, you know, I thought this was interesting. Right now, we live in a culture, in a world, where there is panic. There is a panic in this world. And whether you put your faith or your fear in President Trump, for instance, you're wrong. Because he's not the answer. There was a lie that the enemy has been seducing so many of us to, that there needs to be fear, there needs to be worry, or this is the man who's going to bring hope, and this is the man where we're going to put our faith. Only our faith can only be found in Jesus. Our faith only has any real handles in Jesus. There's nothing else in this life that you can put your faith in that's actually going to help. And there's nothing in this life that you can put your fear in that's actually going to have power over Christ. Faith, I mentioned even a few weeks ago, faith is the same thing as fear. But fear is just putting your faith in something bad. And putting your faith in something that you're afraid of, putting your faith in something that you are scared could happen. It's really what fear is. Fear is faith. Everybody has faith. You just don't use it properly all the time. But this is who Pan was. He was a false god who would present this fear of panic. And I believe that he's still at work today, this false god. Even though they believe that he was a god, I believe it was just a demonic presence. This is another thing this is what they used to do. So to entice Pan to return every year, this is what they would do. They would have orgies and bestiality with goats here at this place. That sounds terrible, and why are you bringing this up? Jesus brought his disciples to this place, and they knew this. He's making a statement. This is basically this area where this cave was and this water coming out. This was like a red light district to the extreme. This was like Bourbon Street to the extreme. This is a place where if you go there, I know exactly why you're going there. So as they're getting closer, his disciples must have been like, does he know where we're going? Does he know what we're doing here? And they begin to walk up, and they see the temple set up, and they see all this stuff where this pagan worship happens, and all this disgusting sexual stuff happens, and they're like, should you tell him or should I tell him? Because I don't think he knows what's up. Jesus then gets there, and he turns around, and he begins to talk. And he begins to tell them about what the church should be, and that the gates of hell, he does know what he's talking about. The gates of hell will not prevail against the church. Jesus is making this statement, and he's saying the gates of hell will not prevail against the church. I believe what Jesus is obviously, to me, if you look at why he goes there, he travels 30 miles to get here. He comes to this place that is obviously sinful. Jesus is talking about the church and the gates of hell in the same sentence. Why would the church have anything to do with this? Because up to this point, all of our religious leaders, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, they have all made this statement, we ain't letting no dirty sinners in our life. We're not going to be around these sinners. You've got to do all the right things. You bring these sacrifices, and we might talk to you. You got to do things our way, and we might look at you. We might have a conversation with you. Jesus says, this is the church I came to build, that you are going to be right at the gates of hell. You are going to go right where the sinners are. You are going to be going right where you felt uncomfortable. My calling and my church that I'm setting up is to be in the mix of a world of sin. But be careful. He said, because when you're in the mix, I want you to, Jesus is making these statements, and I'm telling you all the history of this so that you understand that the disciples understood all this. It's risky to live your life going after people who are living in sin, because you can easily be seduced as well. You can easily be caught up as well. But don't let the fear, Don't let Pan seduce you to fear to keep you away from making a difference, because he's so seductive. This false god, this demonic power is not only going to try to seduce you, but he's going to want to keep those who are already seduced, and he wants to keep the church out, because he knows that if the church comes in, the gates of hell don't stand a chance. But we need to be a people who are willing to go to where the lost are, go to where those who are searching for Jesus and don't even know it, don't even care, don't want to hear what you have to say. Jesus says, you're the kind of church, and I'm setting up the kind of church who is going to be in the middle of the mess. Jesus even uses this term as he's talking about this. He says, who do people say that the Son of Man is? You know why he says that? Jesus uses this term, Son of Man, every time he wants to identify with humanity. He's the Son of God, but this phrase that he uses, he says, Son of Man. He says, listen, I'm like you. I'm human too. I am God, but I'm human. I feel what you feel. I have tempted like you're tempted. I know what you're feeling, and I have come to identify with humanity, to come to the gates of hell and to pull people out. I have come to aggressively attack the gates of hell. Now Jesus ends up asking them, you know, who do you say that I am? All of this stuff, and there's this revelation that Peter ends up having. Peter ends up having this revelation, and you know, Jesus says, look, it's not you, it's not just your wisdom, it is God that spoke this to you, but you're right. This is the rock that I'm going to build my church on. Now, I've thought, and there's been a lot of debate, you know, is this rock Peter? Peter has been, you know, he's kind of like called in the Catholic Church the first priest, he's the first pope, he's the man, he's the one that the church was built on. Well, I think Jesus is clearly, if you look at who Peter was, talking about a lot more than just a man. Jesus is talking about the rock of the revelation of who he is. Now remember, Pan is a god, a false god, who would reveal the future, who would reveal revelations to these Greeks and Romans who would come and try to listen to them. Well, Jesus, to stick it to this place, to stick it to this false god, he basically sets up the revelation of all revelations in the place where nothing but false revelations had happened to this point. And he says, you want a revelation? Here's a revelation. I am God incarnate, become man, to come and love people right where they are. I'm the Christ, the eternal one, the Messiah you've been waiting for. That's a revelation. So Jesus makes this statement where he sticks it to the enemy, where he's like, look, I'm coming for you. I'm not just going to play it safe as we play this game back and forth. I'm not going to let you score a couple, but I'm coming for you. I'm coming to slit your throat, enemy. I'm coming to end this. I'm coming to end the power and authority that you've had up to this point. Matthew 16, 21, as the story continues, this is crazy. Well, you see, right after this, they begin to leave. It says, from then on, in verse 21, Jesus began to tell his disciples plainly that it was necessary for him to go to Jerusalem, that he would suffer many terrible things at the hands of the elders and the leading priests and the teachers of religious law, that he would be killed, but on the third day he would be raised from the dead. So he's telling them, look, this is why I came. Just in case you didn't get it, after hanging out with me all this time and seeing how I love people and why I do miracles, in case you didn't get it, I came to die. I came to give my life. Peter, in verse 22, took him aside. Boy, what a bold knucklehead. That he has the bravery to take Jesus aside and be like, correction? Okay, so Peter takes Jesus aside. He begins to reprimand him for saying such things. Heaven forbid, Lord, Like as if Jesus doesn't know more about heaven. Heaven forbid, Lord, he said. This will never happen to you. Jesus turned to Peter and he said, get away from me, Satan. You are a dangerous trap to me. You are seeing things merely from a human point of view, not from God's. Then Jesus said to the disciples, if any of you wants to be my follower, you must give up your own way, take up your cross and follow me. If you try to hang on to your life, you will lose it. But if you give up your life for my sake, you will save it. And what do you benefit if you gain the whole world but lose your soul? Is anything worth more than your soul? You know, Jesus was tempted in this moment. We talk about how Jesus was tempted during the fast, that he was tempted in the garden. He was tempted right here. He was tempted many times to give up the cross, to do something else, to find an easier way out. And Jesus looked at Peter and he says, get away from me, Satan. Peter goes from rock to Satan in five verses. Peter is not the rock that the church is being built on. I'm sorry to tell you. I'm not either. None of us are. We are not the rock. The rock is that Jesus is the Messiah. That's the rock that the church is built on. I'm going to ask the band to come on up as we get ready to close. You know, I think about, why would God even use us? Why would God decide to use us? The fact that these gates of hell are so real, the fact that there was a temptation and a pull from the world, it is obvious, it is real, it is in our face all the time. There is a seduction that the enemy is constantly laying before us. Why in the world would he build his church through people like us? So weak and so easily distracted. Man, we went to a restaurant the other night. As we go to this restaurant, I am reminded of my weakness and the fact that I am not the rock. We're at this restaurant and we walk in and, you know, there's nobody at the front to seat us. And I thought, seriously, let's just turn around and leave. But I decided, oh, I'll stay. I'm going to learn patience today. So we wait. Somebody finally comes. They seat us. And we go and we sit down, and nobody comes. 5 or 10 minutes in, a waiter finally comes. There's no chips and salsa. It's a Mexican restaurant. I'm not telling you where it is, but it's a Mexican restaurant. No chips and salsa. I'm like, where's my chips and salsa? I'm like, I'm trying to be patient here. I'm trying to be easy. I'm trying to be like chill, you know? Nothing comes. Guy finally comes. I'm paying attention to all this on my watch. And I'm like, how long is all this taking? It is at least 30 minutes before he even takes our order. It's over 55 minutes or whatever before we get our food. I'm like impatient. I'm like, what is going on? Do you not see we have children here? They're ready to go to bed. And everybody else is like people coming in the restaurant, sitting down, eating and leaving, and we're still there. Like, where's my food? I'm starting to get so impatient in this moment. And like Brooke ends up taking both of the kids to the restroom. And like, I was like, Brooke, I'm doing well. I'm doing really good. I'm like, I could be so much worse. Well, the dude comes and I didn't really snap, but I like kind of let him know. So like somebody finally brings the food and the waiter comes up. He's like, how is everything? I'm like, it's fine that it's finally here. You know, I tell him this and he's like, oh, okay. Well, I don't really care, but he walks away. And I was like, man, it was like, as he walked away, I was like, I was proud of myself. It was like, I told him, like as if that mattered at all. Brooke comes and she sits down and I'm like, yeah, I told him. I was like, yeah. I said, it's good that it's finally here. Our food that we've been waiting for that you didn't bring, you should come and serve me. I'm going to pay a lot of money for this food. And I'm so impatient in this moment. I'm like, impatience is one. If you know me, you know, I'm not a very patient person. I'm trying to grow in this. And I think that's why I end up in situations like that all the time. But I'm trying to grow in this. But I just felt why am I continually dealing with this? And I had to, in my heart, I had to repent and be like, God, I'm sorry. I want to grow in patience, but do you have another way to teach me? Could you not put me in situations where I have to learn this? But I tell you this because I'm constantly reminded that I don't have a lot of rock characteristics in me. I don't have a lot in me that I can take the credit for and be like, God, you build a church on my shoulders. I got this thing. I am aware of my weakness. I am aware of my plural weaknesses. I am aware of the fact that I'm not the rock that he talked about. I barely even have the revelation of Jesus every day. It's not even close to about us. It's all about him. It's all about Jesus. It's all about what he has done. But what he has done is he has given us a way out of the seduction and the temptation of sin in all of us. So whether it is as simple And as seemingly insignificant as having more patience, or if it is something more hardcore, more serious, as a sin that you have not been able to shake, that you are ashamed to tell anyone about, Jesus came to attack the gates of hell in your life and to give you freedom from it so that you could then loose someone else and so that you could bind the enemy up in your life. There is a power in the name of Jesus that all of us have access to who are followers of Christ. Jesus is calling the church to attack the gates of hell. And I would ask you today, are you going to do that with me? I want to be the kind of church, I want to be the kind of person that attacks the gates of hell on a regular basis. That when I hear the flute playing, that when I hear the seduction of sin, that I'm going to recognize it for what it is, and not only attack the enemy in that moment and say, no, you're not going to have this, but I'm going to be the kind of example and be the kind of help for those of us who need it. I want all of us, all of us need to be.
Thank you so much for joining us for this week's message from Anchor Chapel. If you're interested in supporting the ministry of Anchor, you can easily do so by visiting our website, anchorchapel.com. You can also follow us on social media at Anchor Chapel. God bless, and we'll see you next week.